Hi, my name is Gabe. I'm a mathematician and a tutor, and I'm excited to work with you all on some statistics today. Today's topic is calculating confidence intervals for single population proportions. We will start with a quick review on the general structure of a confidence interval. Then we will define and describe the structure of a confidence interval for the particular case of a single population proportion. Finally, once we have the formula for this type of confidence interval, we will compute a confidence interval on an example problem. Let's get started by looking at the kind of problem that we can answer with a proportion question. One of the most important things for a train to be is on time. Trains are designed to run on very precise schedules, so one train being late can cause huge problems for the entire system, not to mention anyone who is on the late train. A train operator might be interested in the proportion of their trains that arrive on time versus the proportion that arrive late. This can be useful for keeping track of performance across years or pointing out flaws in the system. It is possible that the system has a true population parameter of on-time rate, which we will refer to as P. This is the proportion of trains that are on time if the system were allowed to run the way that it does forever. If the train operator, however, wants to get an estimate for this population parameter, they would probably sample a subset of their historical record, maybe during certain months or for certain lines. From this sample proportion, P hat, they would then want to construct a confidence interval to provide an interval estimate of the population parameter. Let's take a look into how we construct such a confidence interval for a single population proportion by first discussing the general structure of a confidence interval. Confidence intervals all begin with the sample statistic at their center. From there, we add and subtract by a factor consisting of two components, a multiplier, which is dependent on the desired confidence level and the underlying distribution of the sample, and a standard error. The standard error is a function of the sample statistic, some metric of the sample variance, which we will discuss for each statistic, and the sample size. The following table summarizes the components of this general structure. The sample size, a sample statistic, the confidence level, and some form of standard error are all required to calculate a confidence interval. Notationally, the confidence level is frequently associated with the value 1 minus alpha, which is itself the significance level. This is important when consulting lookup tables for the multipliers. For example, a 95% confidence interval leads to a 5% significance level. For the single population proportion, we will focus on the sample size, the sample proportion p hat, a confidence level, a z multiplier related to the normal distribution, and a standard error, which will be a function of the sample proportion and the sample size. Let's start actually writing down some equations for this confidence interval. The confidence interval for a single population proportion is centered at the sample proportion. We then add or subtract a term composed of a z multiplier times a standard error term. The z multiplier is dependent on the significance level over 2 to specify that we are working with a two-tailed confidence interval and is derived from the standard normal distribution. In general, this multiplier must be higher for higher confidence levels. As a rule of thumb, a 95% confidence level requires a z multiplier of around 2. The standard error for a population proportion is equal to the square root of the fraction p hat times the quantity 1 minus p hat divided by the sample size n. This standard error is smallest for proportions around 0.5. Similarly, this term gets smaller as sample sizes get larger. These trends reflect the fact that larger data sets with proportions around 50% tend to be the most normally distributed data sets, and thus we do not need to account for as much possible error. When we put this together, we are able to make a claim about the probability of a population proportion being found within a certain range around a sample proportion. Explicitly, we can write that the probability that the population proportion p lies between p hat minus z star times the standard error and p hat plus z star times the standard error is equal to the confidence level as a probability. Written down, this is an intimidating formula, but breaking down each term into its parts should let us work with it relatively easily. Let's see how this works with our train example. Recall that in this example, we are trying to generate a confidence interval on the proportion of on-time trains for some train system. Let's gather some data about the system. Let's say that the train operators monitor 100 trains for a sample size of n equals 100 and observe that 85% of their trains are on time for a p hat of 0.85. Additionally, the operator wants to develop a 95% confidence interval, so that C1 equals 95%, and a 99% confidence interval, so that C2 equals 0.99. In order to solve this problem, we are going to have to identify our z-score multiplier for both cases and the standard error term, which will be the same for both cases. Let's start with the standard error term. We know that the equation for the standard error of a single population proportion is the square root of the quantity p hat times 1 minus p hat divided by the sample size n. Given a sample size of 100 and a p hat of 0.85, 0.85, we have that the standard error term is equal to the square root of 0.85 times 0.15 divided by 100. This leads to a standard error result of 0.036. Next, we have to determine the value of the Z multiplier for both the 95% and 99% confidence levels. The notation of Z star with the corresponding significance level divided by 2 is just notation to indicate that we are looking at a two-tailed significance level. We get the appropriate values by consulting a standard normal distribution. To find the Z-score for a 95% confidence level, we need to find the value of the Z-score that shades in 95% of the interior of the standard normal distribution. This happens at a Z-score of approximately plus or minus 1.96, yielding a Z-multiplier of 1.96 for the 95% confidence level. If we repeat the process for the Z-multiplier of the 99% confidence interval, we'll find a Z-score of 2.58. With all of this information, we can now go back and calculate our two confidence intervals. Let's start with the 95% confidence interval. Recall that the confidence interval for the single population proportion is equal to p hat plus or minus the z-score times the standard error. For the 95% confidence level, we have that p hat equals 0.58, z star equals 1.96, and the standard error is equal to 0.036. From here, we can calculate the lower bound of the confidence interval as 0.85 minus 1.96 times 0.036. This yields a lower bound of 0.78. Similarly, the upper bound is equal to 0.85 plus 1.96 times 0.036. This yields 0.92. So, how do we interpret these results? Well, we can now make the following claim. Probability that the true proportion of on-time trains is between 78% and 92% is equal to 0.95. But what about the 99% confidence rating? This may be helpful to evaluate the best or worst case scenarios for the operator. We can follow the same process to construct the confidence interval, but just change our inputs to include the 99% confidence level z-score, or 1% significance level z-score, which is equal to 2.58. Pause the video for a moment to see if you can construct the upper and lower bounds of this confidence interval on your own. If you can, what do you notice about the results? Is the confidence interval bigger or smaller? Hopefully you've taken a moment to perform that calculation. Let's start with the lower bound, which is equal to 0.85 minus 2.58 times 0.036, yielding 0.76. The upper bound is then equal to 0.85 plus 2.58 times 0.036, giving us 0.94. Let's compare these bounds to the 95% confidence interval. We already have that there's a 95% chance of the true on-time proportion being between 0.78 and 0.92. With our 99% confidence rating, we can now say that the probability that the true proportion lies between 0.76 and 0.94 is 0.99. Notice how the 99% confidence level requires a larger range of probable values for the true proportion. This reflects the fact that a 99% confidence rating has to account for more extreme possibilities and randomness, which leads to a greater interval estimate. Hopefully this has provided an interesting look at some of the ways that confidence intervals for a single population proportion are constructed and interpreted. We started this lesson by recalling the general structure of confidence intervals. We then followed this up by specifying the form of the standard error and the multiplicative factor for a single population proportion confidence interval. We specified that the multiplication factor for such confidence intervals is drawn from the standard normal distribution. Finally, we put these formulae to use by creating a 95% and 99% confidence interval for an example problem. We discussed how to use the standard normal to get the proper Z multiplier and explored how a higher confidence level necessarily leads to a wider confidence interval.
For more examples and specific forms of these discrete variables, I encourage you to keep learning about them in various other places on Chegg.